beautiful, incredibly gorgeous spring Sunday morning. Let's all stand together and sing, okay? Stand if you're able. Let's turn to 139, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
A beautiful sunrise this morning. Amen. Joel looked over to make sure I was standing there. And apparently, I'm a little bit lost this morning. You'd be praying. Brother Kendall is preaching in another church this morning for us, and so is Brother Josh. Both of them are out preaching in other churches, and that's just a neat, that's a neat kind of thing, you know, and appreciate those men and their ministries. And I miss them, and I was thinking about it as I was, that's where my mind had gone. If you're wondering where I lost my mount, I think I found it, okay, but once again, it is good to be in the house of God, and I'm so glad that you're here today. Let's pray together and ask God to bless. Heavenly Father, we are thankful, Lord God, that you are there for us to rest upon, to lean on, that you have promised us that you'll never leave us or forsake us. You've promised us a a place in heaven, and you also promised us that you'd continue to do that work in our life throughout our life here on earth, as we just read in Philippians. And so, God, I ask that you'd give us a special favor today. Watch over us, speak to our hearts. Lord, above all, Holy Spirit of God, I pray that you would speak to us through the fellowship, through the singing, Lord, through the certainly through the preaching, through the baptism, the altar call, and all that we have going on today. Holy Spirit of God, do a work for us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You can be seated.
Amen. The choir is singing a selection from the hymn book. If you'd like to follow along in the words, to be able to really hear and know the words, they're very special. It's number 116 as we sing. Amazing. Let's continue singing. Stand with me again. Turn to number 79. To God be the glory. That's number 79 in your hymnals.
Atonement for
the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Great things he hath taught us, great things he hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Well, we've got a few announcements for you this morning, and God is always good, isn't he? He gives us the opportunity to serve him. Remember, as a child, carrying pieces of drywall or something or logs and working in the woods with my dad. My dad would say, "Here, son, give me a hand." I was in his way. He didn't need my hand. I'm holding on to the end of something, and he's grunting and groaning, carrying it, and I'm holding on to the end, think I'm working with my dad. And often that's the way God is, isn't it? He says, "Here, son, give me a hand with this." And we get to be part of what God is doing. So when you see the different ministries that we have, God wants to partner with us in our labors. And so we see things here that are going on throughout the week. We have our ladies' Bible study Tuesday at 10 o'clock right here at the church. And appreciate you ladies that take part in that. We'll have also at 1 o'clock the Bearing Precious Seed Scripture Assembly going on. We've just about got another pallet ready to go back over to Lansing, another, 10,000, 12,000 scriptures. And so come on out. If you can fold paper, you have a place to serve with this Bearing Precious Seed ministry. If you can't come regularly, but you can come once, or you can only come for a half hour, come on. That's just exciting to be able to see it happening. This is something that we just started back up again, the Not Ashamed Street Preaching and Tract Distribution Ministry. Will start Friday at 5 o'clock in Lapeer. And brother, I'm going to say down by the old courthouse, okay? That's where we'll be, on the courthouse corner there in Lapeer. So come on over for that. And we just started this last week. It was cold this last week. Vicky almost looked like she was homeless. She had a hood pulled down like this, and she had a big coat on, and she was sitting there like this, holding her sign. But we had a good time anyhow. Get the word of God out. You know, you might be a blessing to somebody just by, or allow the whole. Hey, when we make a contact, the Holy Spirit begins to work. whether that's handing out a tract, lifting up a scripture sign, doing a Gospel of John and Romans, send it to the foreign field, whatever. Even smiling and saying, God bless you to somebody. You're beginning a work in somebody's heart because the Holy Spirit will take that seed and use it. So you be faithful with that. Also, we are having, after the evening service tonight, Brother Kendall's going to be back for the evening, so we will be having choir practice at the regular time at 4:30, and we are having a vacation Bible school meeting after the evening service tonight. Also, there is a box in the lobby that we have assigned by, and that is for anyone that would like to donate to Vacation Bible School so that you maybe you can't be here to help with Vacation Bible School, or maybe the Lord just laid it on your heart, you want to give a little money towards that. We've got the box out there. We've got money that is set aside in our budget for VBS, but this is an opportunity for you personally to step in and help meet some of those needs. I think there was another $50 in there, Pam, so I think we're up to $130, $150 that has come in for VBS. Stompers and Chompers, okay? Stompers and Chompers. It's all about dinosaurs. Kids get excited about dinosaurs. So if you notice, my mom brought a dinosaur in this morning. Not too many people's mothers, 80-something-year-old mothers, have dinosaurs. My I didn't say she's a dinosaur. Help me out. Oh, no, she's looking. I'm in trouble now. Could tell you, Mom made this great big paper mache dinosaur in her apartment, and I looked at her. I said, Mom, did you measure that? Can you get it out the door? She managed to get it out the door, but I think it was probably rubbing on both sides. But anyway, that's for the Stompers and Chompers Vacation Bible School coming up. So you'll see a dinosaur in the lobby. Okay, let's see here. Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, at 9:30, we're going to have our breakfast, our Easter breakfast in the fellowship hall, and that's going to be during the Sunday school hour. We'll be having our regular, we've done it now for a couple of years, and so come on in at 9:30, and then immediately following that, we'll go into our morning service, our regular time for our morning service at 10:45, and our Easter cantata. The choir will be performing the Easter cantata at that time. And then we'll have, I promise you, I'll preach the gospel that day. Bring in your loved ones. Bring in your family members. A great Sunday to invite people to church. I say it over and over again, and I think to emphasize it. Sometimes people will only come to church on Easter or Christmas. Well, don't fuss about that. Just make sure they come here on Easter or Christmas, okay? And I promise you, they'll hear a compassionate presentation of the Word of God, of the gospel, on that Sunday morning. Okay, let's see. Saturday, April 8th, there will be a special tract distribution at the Walmart parking lot. Okay, I need 100 tracts passed out. I'm with a group of pastors throughout Michigan. Pastor Chatfield is trying to get every Walmart in Michigan to be have a church represented handing out tracts in that Walmart parking lot. Now, it's not an all-day thing or anything like that, but if you are willing to pass out, let's say, 10 tracts at Walmart, come and see me. I've got one person so far. That means I'm passing out 90 tracts at Walmart. Okay, I need some help. And this is a good way to get outside of your comfort zone, give somebody the gospel, and I believe that God will bless it. I don't know how many Walmarts there are in Michigan, but somebody probably is Googling it right now. Okay, but that's a lot of gospel tracts, so we can take our part in that, and that's going to be that special day on Saturday, April 8th. Also, this is new. We are in the process. Hold that paper up for me right there, Kathy. This is something that we've been working on, thank you, getting everybody's names and addresses and phone numbers and spellings of people's names and stuff. Everybody that comes to our church, whether you're a member or not, we want to get you on this list. What we're going to do, starting Sunday, April 16th, we'll be taking pictures and collecting information after the morning service for a new church directory. If you cannot make it on this date, see Brother Kendall or Miss Ashley to schedule a different time. This is for all of our church family, okay? Say, well, I only come every now and then. You're part of our church family. We want you to be in this. And many people have said to me, Pastor, I would like to write so-and-so a note. Rosemary, I had several people ask me what your address was, because we wanted to send you a note or give you a call. This way, you'll have it and be able to do that without bothering me. Okay? No, you'll have that in your hand, be able to do it. It comes in great when it's time for Christmas cards and things as well, or just want to make a phone call. So starting Sunday, April 16th, we're not doing anything super fancy. We're not bringing in a professional photographer, but it's always nice to be able to put a face with the name. And many times I'll look at, so I say, I know you. I cannot remember your name. And everybody wants to have their name remembered. So Sunday, April 16th, we're going to be doing this church directory. Okay, before we have our ushers come, I'm sure that we have some first-time visitors here with us today. You don't have to say anything. We're not trying to embarrass you in any way. But our ushers right now are grabbing those coffee mugs back there. Even as I speak, Ron is reaching for those coffee mugs. I don't know. Okay. I'm sorry. Ron was just looking at me. Okay. If you are a first-time visitor here at our church, get your hand up in the air very quickly. We've got some. Come on. I know there are a few of you in here. There you go. Come on. Yes. They're all coming to see Jeremiah get baptized. Make sure the folks get a. Amen. Get a. Thank you, Brother Ron. No, Ron's going to be. Okay. All right. And what is your name again? Thelma. Okay, she'd been here before, and she did not get a coffee mug. So we're going to make sure that Thelma gets one, okay? All right, let's give our visitors a hand this morning. Okay, Brother Ron, if you still love me, go ahead and grab the offering plates, and you all come forward for the offering, if you would, please. Pray for Ron's wife, Diana. She's in the hospital. She's still in the hospital, Brother Ron? She came home Friday. Praise the Lord. Continue to pray for her. Ushers, why don't you come at this time and we'll have our offering, receive our offering. It's good to have Shirley back with us. Shirley was in the hospital. Good to have her back. Pray for Rosemary and the Davis family with the homegoing of Brother Doug last Sunday. Rosemary, when you sent me that note, I didn't realize what we were walking into, but you know, it was a good thing. And we were able to be right there with Brother Doug as he left this world. He stopped breathing in this world and took a big gasp of air up there. And he's forever with the Lord, and we're so excited about that. Had the funeral and things here this last week. All right, let's bow for prayer, and we'll ask the Lord to bless our offering today. Brother Don, pray for us, please. Amen. Amen. When I go back for baptism, just keep singing. You know, even if you sing something that we've already sung today, that's fine. How about if I get a couple of guys to make sure that the pulpit gets moved?
We'll make sure.
Okay. Yeah, David Gilliland is going in the back with Jeremiah and myself, and he's just going to make sure he has his towel and all that kind of stuff. Amen. Shut my mic off, guys, would you please?
Amen. Well, the children are excused now at this time for Children's Church. Let's all join together and stand, singing number 514. 514. Seated. Our brother Ernie will come now to sing for us.
It's God's and God's alone. God, God alone is fit to take the universe's throne. Let everything that lives reserve its truest praise for God and God alone. God and God alone will be the joy of our eternal home. He will be our one desire. Our hearts will never tire of God and God alone. God and God alone is fit to take the universe's throne. Let everything that lives reserve its truest praise, for God and God alone. Let everything that lives reserve its truest praise, for God and God alone.
I liked it better that way. Okay. Good job. All right, let's take our Bibles and turn to Jeremiah, if you would please. Jeremiah chapter 24. Jeremiah chapter 24. I've said a few times here in this last week, it's good just sometimes to let the Bible, just leave it on, turn it on. Let the Bible, just the words of God just float through your mind. And I've been doing that a lot just recently. I've been driving a lot, going back and forth to the hospital and things, and we've had people in the last maybe 3 weeks that we've had in the hospital coming back and forth. And often what I'll do is I'll set my Bible onto my, to play through my speakers on my car. And I've been reading through that way, having the Bible read to me, the book of Isaiah, the book of Jeremiah. And even doing it that way, something, every now and then, something will just jump out and sticks with you. And felt as though I needed to go back and read this chapter over again when I had some time. And Lord gave me some thoughts with Jeremiah chapter 24. We're going to read the entire chapter. There's only 10 verses. So let's all stand for the reading of God's word today. Jeremiah chapter 24. And I'll begin reading in verse 1. The Lord showed me, and behold, two baskets of figs were set before the temple of the Lord. After that, Nebuchadrezzar, king of Babylon, had carried away captive Jeconiah, the son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, and the princes of Judah, with the carpenters and smiths from Jerusalem, and had brought them to Babylon. One basket had very good figs, even like the figs that are first ripe, and the other basket had very naughty figs, which could not be eaten. They were so bad. Then said the Lord unto me, What seest thou, Jeremiah? And I said, Figs, the good figs, very good, and the evil, very evil, that cannot be eaten. They are so evil. Again the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Thus saith the Lord, the God of Israel, Like these good figs, so will I acknowledge them that are carried away captive of Judah, whom I have sent out of this place into the land of the Chaldeans for their good. For I will set mine eyes upon them for good, and I will bring them again to this land, and I will build them and not pull them down, and I will plant them and not pluck them up. And I will give them an heart to know me, that I am the Lord, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. For they shall return unto me with their whole heart. And as the evil figs, which cannot be eaten, they are so evil. Surely, thus saith the Lord, so will I give Zedekiah the king of Judah and his princes and the residue of Jerusalem that remain in this land and them that dwell in the land of Egypt. And I will deliver them to be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth for their hurt, to be a reproach and a proverb, a taunt and a curse in all places whither I shall drive them. And I will send the sword, the famine, and the pestilence among them, till they be consumed from off the land that I gave unto them and to their fathers. And let's pray. Father, we ask that you would bless the reading of your word today. And God, I pray that it would make clear sense to us as you have given us these illustrations in the Old Testament. Now, Lord, I pray that you would bless us, give us exactly what we need from this service. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Did you notice it said in the bulletin, make sure your phones are shut off? Mine was just buzzing up there. Would you shut that off, please? Oh. Now, this passage of Scripture, when we read it, at first, it probably is one of those things that's pretty easy to go in one ear and out the other. But there's a picture that is being given here in the Word of God. And out in front of the temple, there are two baskets of fruit, of figs. And one basket is prime. It's perfect. It's flawless. It's perfectly ripe. It just come to the time of its ripening. It's at its sweetest. You know, like that banana just before it goes too black. You know what I mean? It's got a few spots on it. You know, boy, this is good. This is going to be sweet. And you've got that fruit, perfect fruit, ready to eat. And then right next to it, there was a basket of the Bible calls naughty. I thought that's kind of funny. Naughty fruit. Naughty. I just picture somebody going, shame on you. That naughty fruit or evil fruit, what it was saying, it was so bad, it was so evil that you couldn't even imagine eating it. I'm thinking the fruit was probably moldy. It was probably maybe even beyond moldy and crusty. Nasty, nasty fruit. I remember as a little boy, my mom came for some event for my kindergarten. I remember this, Mom. Now, if it's not right, just nod your head and act like I'm saying it right, okay? And I'll never call you a dinosaur again, okay, Ma? But I remember my mother finding I had a little locker type thing there. And inside of that locker, I had a little bag or something like that. And she pulled it out. I remember something like this. And I had a banana peel in there that had been in there for a long time. And it became a naughty banana peel, okay? It was bad. Do you ever find like some fruit someplace? You wonder what in the world is going on? What, I smell something? Where are all these fruit flies coming from? And then you remember stuck in a closet where you normally wouldn't put it, a cupboard or something. There's some apples or there's some fruit of some type and they're nasty. And it's like you don't even hardly want to touch them. You go get your gloves on and to move it because it's really rancid. It's really bad. I did that one time with a fox carcass. I put it in the trunk of my car, thinking I'm just going to go out to some back road and throw it out, and I forgot it until I saw those great big blowflies in the car. They're going, these flies, they barely can fly because they're so big. I'm wondering, where do these flies come from? And then it dawned on me, and so I held my breath, opened up the trunk, and it was a bad situation, okay? It was bad. It was naughty. It was evil, is what the Bible is saying here. So you have this this beautiful basket of fruit. And then you have this basket of fruit that is well past its prime. It's to the point where now it's rotten, it's foul. You could never bring yourself to eat it. You saw this there. The image came to Jeremiah. And now here's the story behind it, and we'll get on with the preaching. What had happened, Jeremiah was, what was he known as? Anybody? Jeremiah the weeping or crying prophet, the weeping prophet. Well, he was there when Judah and Jerusalem, the capital city, went into captivity into Babylon. And he saw all of that. In the preceding chapters, we have Babylon has come and laid siege to the city of Jerusalem. And God told Jeremiah, he said, you tell the people to surrender. Don't fight. He said, they are coming in my name. They're coming to do my work. You need this. This is for the good of the city of Jerusalem. This is for the good of your people. I'm going to take you into captivity for a number of years, but I will bring you back and restore you to this land. And so Jeremiah went and told the king, and he made it known that God had told him that. The Bible says, I think it may have been the priest, somebody smashed him right in the face, just slapped him publicly, slapped him for saying it, and said, what a terrible thing, and they wound up imprisoning him for speaking what God had told him. And so you had God's plan was for the people to go into captivity into Babylon. And so you have some that had surrendered and gone on or were taken away. And you had some that were fighting the idea of going into captivity. You had the good fruit, that was the people. The good fruit was the good the people that were obeying God, and God was going to do this for their benefit. This, although it's a bad situation, this is what God had planned for you. You go ahead, step out, it's okay. God's going to take care of you. The bad basket of fruit represented the people that fought against the king Nebuchadnezzar here. They fought against him and wouldn't surrender. And some of them even fled into Egypt rather than surrendering to Babylon. And God was saying, I'm going to restore the people that did what I told them to do. And then the people that didn't do what I told them to do, it's going to be very difficult on them. They're going to be scattered all over the world. They're going to be pursued. They're going to have pestilence. They're going to have all kinds of problems. Now, the point that I want to make about these two baskets of fruit is it went from, if you have a basket of fruit, it goes from being good to being bad very quickly. The choice was for the people, surrender now or bad things are going to happen. What basket of fruit do you want to be a part of, really, is what he was saying. You've got this good basket of fruit or this evil basket of fruit or this absolutely rotten basket of fruit. You need to make the choice, which one, because very quickly it goes from good to bad. I think that we could all agree that there are circumstances in our life that seem like everything's going okay, and then it can turn bad very quickly. It really can. And here, this is talking about obedience. We think we have a long time to decide whether we're going to do what God is saying to do or not do what God is saying to do. We can decide. I'm going to put that off. That good basket of fruit can very quickly become a rotten, evil, vile basket of fruit if we wait too long. We see that in Numbers chapter 14, that the children of Israel, they had come, the Hebrews had come out of Egypt. And they'd not been long out of Egypt, and they now are standing there ready to go into the promised land. The 12 spies had gone in, and Joshua and Caleb had come back, and they said, hey, yeah, there's giants in the land. There's walled cities, yes, this is all true, but there's also great bounty, a great land flowing with milk and honey, and the grapes are so big that a bunch of grapes, it takes two men with a pole to carry one bunch of grapes, and all of these things. And he said, there's amazing. And so they took a vote, and it was 10 spies against the two, and so the Israelites said, we're not going to go in. Matter of fact, they went as far as to say, Moses, you messed us up. We were better off in Egypt. We're better off being slaves, starving at the hands of the Egyptians, rather than to be here. And they said, we're not going in. Well, then through Moses, God gave a message and railed against the people that refused to go in and said, this is what's going to happen. You're going to wander for years in the wilderness until you die. Your carcass, and that's the term that's used, your carcass is going to be buried in the wilderness. You will not go into the promised land. Well, they went back and chewed on that for a little while, and they said, wait a second. They came back the next day and said, we're going, they arrayed themselves like they're going to go into Moses. What are you folks doing? He said, well, we're going into the promised land. We changed our mind. And this is one of those occurrences in Scripture where one day made all the difference. They had the opportunity to go in on this day. They said no. Then they changed their mind and said, now we're ready to go in. And Moses just told them, no, that's not the way this works. You had your chance. now your children, that you were so afraid that we're going to be harmed by going into the promised land. Your children are the ones that are going to go into the promised land. After we bury your sorry carcass, I added the word sorry, your sorry carcass here in the wilderness. Some of those people lived for 40 years. Some of them died that day. If you got 1 million people, you got people dying every day. Some of that, every day, what they would do is they would have a funeral, and men would go out into that wilderness, and they'd dig a hole in the ground, and they'd have that body prepared. Why? Because one more person died in the wilderness. They did not go into the promised land until every single one of them had died. Do you see the difference that one day made? One day. See, God allowed Joshua and Caleb to go into the promised land. I believe that if somebody would have said, if somebody in that whole congregation of very likely as many as 2 million people had said, wait a second, I'm on Joshua and Caleb's side. I'm standing with Joshua and Caleb, 2 against 2 million. That you'd have stood out in the crowd. Okay? I'm with Joshua and Caleb. I believe that God certainly would have said, well, I guess we have 3 going in then, not 2. But that didn't happen. That one day made the difference. Just think of this. Over in the book of Genesis, I'm not sure how long it was. We have some historians will try to give you a date from the time of creation. I don't know how you give a date for creation, but from the time of creation to the flood of Noah. But it was many, many years, and you had people that lived for 1,000 years that didn't live till the time of the flood, so it was quite a while. The pre-flood world, and yet the Bible says it got worse and worse and worse and more corrupt and more vile, more and more vulgar, much like our society is doing today, is running like a freight train with no brakes going downhill and greasy rails, and all we can do as the people of God is pray against it, work against it, live for God, stand for what's true, and be on God's side, be on the side of the 2 witnesses rather than the 10. But anyway, the civilization was going downhill quickly, and God said, I'm just going to kill them all. I'm going to do that. I'm just going to wipe out man. But then he said, we see that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And God told Noah, I want you to go out and I want you to build this ark. Hebrew folklore, I read this the other day, says when God told him you're going to build an ark, one of the first things Noah did was he went out and planted some trees. No, that doesn't say that in the Bible, but that's just Hebrew folklore that he went and did that. He, in other words, when he was told that, he took it to heart and he started planning, I need to build this ark. And over 100 years, we know that Noah preached righteousness and preached that judgment was coming. And he was mocked and he was ridiculed by the great population of the world. People would have 30 or 40 children. Well, how could they do that? They lived to be 1,000 years old, nearly 1,000 years old, and they were able to bear children for decades. And so the population of the world was not like it is today, but there was many, many people on this planet. And then what happened is God said, okay, Noah, we got the ark. Okay, God caused the animals to come into the ark, 2 by 2, many of them, and some 7 at a time because they were pure ones, those who were using for sacrifices and such. And he get those onto the ark. And then he said, Noah, get on the ark. One of the miracles of miracles. Noah stepped on that ark. His wife followed him after over 100 years of this. His wife followed. Not only that, here's a miracle of miracles. His 3 sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, got on that ark with them. And not only that, their wives got on that ark with them. They're sitting there on dry ground. They'd never heard of rain, never saw rain. The Bible says they were in there and God shut the door. They were in that ark for 7 days before it started raining. Can you imagine what happened in those 7 days? The crowds would come and they would laugh. They'd probably throw stuff against the side of the ark. I can imagine it. And they would mock Noah, and they would criticize him and make fun of him and throw rotten tomatoes against the side of the thing and maybe write graffiti on the side of the ark and all that kind of stuff and laugh and mock him. Then the Bible says the fountains of the deep broke. That means water came up from underneath. It wasn't just rain coming down. The fountains of the deep broke up and water bubbled up from the ground. The Bible says that that great canopy in the heavens released its water, and all that water came gushing down all at one time. The from the fountains of the deep broke, and the great canopy that was surrounding the earth in the atmosphere, all of that water dropped down onto the planet. And here they are. I think somebody maybe that had a tomato in their hand. And very likely they went over, instead of throwing rocks at the door, very likely they said, Noah, let us in. Hey, we were just kidding. Noah, you know me. I'm your neighbor, let me in. Noah, I'm your relative, I'm your cousin, let me in. But God had shut the door. Now you see the difference a day makes. One day, they're mocking and reviling him, laughing at him. And the next day, they're screaming out to God. They're screaming out to Noah. Instead of trying to mock him, they're, please, let me in. But God had shut the door. I think Noah would have opened it if he could have. I really do. It could have been a brother or a sister on the outside of that ark that he heard their voice and couldn't open the door. Might have been a neighbor, might have been a loved one, maybe a close friend, an acquaintance. Or maybe just for the nature of the whole thing, maybe just his love for all mankind, he would have opened that door if he could have, but God said, no, you had your chance. Your time is done. The door is shut. Here's a lesson. The God that spans all of eternity past, which is something we can't not even fathom. The God of all eternity past and who reaches well beyond all eternity future chooses to deal with us on a daily basis. We think sometimes because it's been so long from the past and there's, you know, the Alpha and the Omega, and you have infinity that way and infinity this way, that we have all that time to make choices. But just like that, those baskets of fruit, they had to choose which basket they were going to be in. Am I going to surrender like the prophet said to? Which sort of goes against my grain and would go against your grain. Okay, I understand why they wouldn't want to, but boy, what a tragic mistake. They had an opportunity and the ripe fruit became spoiled fruit in their life. Those that were standing there reviling Moses and criticizing Moses for having led them out of Egypt and who now wanted to change their mind and say, okay, we'll surrender, we'll submit. Moses had to say, sorry, that was yesterday's offer. That offer's not on the table anymore. You think about that with Noah. Yesterday, you could have sided with Noah. You could have. He was preaching righteousness. You could have accepted it. You could have accepted the preaching of the Word of God through Noah, but you didn't. And now, in this expanse of eternity past all the way on through eternity future, there was a period of time, and here that was time to make a decision, and you made the wrong one, folks. And time is up. The God of eternity past and eternity future deals with us on a daily basis. Here's something a little philosophical. I told my wife, I said, I got to be careful. I don't want to get too philosophical. But you understand this. Nothing gets done tomorrow. Nothing. And you know something? We can't really even do anything yesterday. All we can do is learn the lessons of the past and anticipate the future. But folks, we only have one moment in which to live, and that's now. Yes, He is the God of eternity past. He's the God of eternity future, but He deals with us. Hmm. 11:43. Hmm. I know what time it is, by the way. Sometimes you wonder, does Pastor really know what time it is? Yeah, it's 11:43. I've got my watch, and I've got digital clock, and I've got a regular clock back there. I don't pay attention to any of them. No, I'm kidding. It's 11:43. It must have just turned 11:43. Still 11:43. Sometimes a minute can be a lifetime. That's another philosophical point. Oh, it's 11. I took my eyes off it for a second. Isn't that the way it always happens? It's now 11:44. Ooh. We can't go back and live 11:43. We can't do it. You know, I can anticipate 11:45, but I can't live 11:45. I can only live 11:44. Boast not thyself of tomorrow. Know it not what a day may bring forth. I wasn't expecting that last Sunday, Rosemary. I don't think my heart was really ready for it. Are you ever, really? Sitting there watching our brother Doug. Doug's very special to me. To be able to be there and watch him, watch his spirit take flight and leave this body, absent from the body, present with the Lord. We watched him. He opened his eyes for about the last, maybe 5 or 10 minutes? Opened his eyes, looked around. But you know, we can't go back. I can't go back to December 28th at 4:10 in the morning. I can't go back there. I can't go back to 4:09 and hold my dad's hand again. I can't do it. I want to do it. The time's past. Time's past. And we mourn and we grieve about that. But also we can look back and rejoice. The fact that maybe we did some things right. Maybe we brought some glory to the Lord somewhere, even in that difficult time. And we look back and say, man, I'm glad I did. I'm glad I did. I'm glad I did. I told my dad, I love you, Dad. The last minutes of his life, I said it over and over and over. Dad, I love you. I love you, Dad. I love you, Dad. Because I knew the time was coming where I wouldn't be able to say it anymore. So I said it over and over again as the clock was ticking. And I'm sorry, I don't mean to play on your emotions, but there's nothing like death that makes time more relevant. Hey, there's going to be a time where you will not be able to do what you do today. I've been here long enough to watch some of our dear people, some of you right here, go from being strong and very, I can do it, to trying to get through the day. I'm struggling a little bit. What? I mean, it just goes like that. So the Lord deals with us day by day. Day by day, we have opportunities. I can only live today. I can't live tomorrow. I can't live yesterday. I will do nothing tomorrow. Nothing gets done tomorrow. Whenever you do it, it's going to be today. Whenever it gets done. Sure, we plan for the future, and we ought to plan for the future. We have events that we look forward to, and we have days that we're not really looking so forward to. But we know they're coming. We try to anticipate them. We try to prepare for them. But the fact is, I can't live that day until I get to that day. Kind of philosophical, but not really. It just makes very good sense. That basket of fruit, which once was good and good to eat and pleasant, became something rotten very quickly. Time passed. That rotten fruit is never going to be good fruit ever again. The opportunity is past. See, the Bible tells us that God leads us day by day. the Old Testament tells us of the pillar of fire that was at night and the pillar of cloud by day for the children of Israel when they're in the wilderness. Remember, they had been told they can't go into the promised land, but God didn't back away from them. God said, I'm going to be with you every day that you're going to be in this wilderness. And when the cloud moves, this great big pillar of cloud that's over the tabernacle, when it moves, you better bundle up your tents and follow, because that's where I want you to go. And day by day, they had to do whatever they were doing with sort of looking over their shoulder, wondering, I wonder if today is the day he's going to want us to move. Not if that today is the day that Moses wants us to move, but this is the day that God wants us to move. And so they're watching over, hey, it's moving. Take down the tent. You know, there are times that they stayed weeks and months and even years in one place. They didn't move every single day. But when that cloud moved, they moved. They had to move. God leads us day by day. Oh, this is so human, but it's foolish in a way to be worried about your tomorrow when you're not taking care of your today. Isn't that really a typical human behavior? We'll sit there worrying, we'll sit there on the couch and we'll be worrying about what's going to happen tomorrow, and what we just did is wasted our entire day, the day that we had, worrying about what was going to take place tomorrow. Now I understand, there's our things that we're concerned about and all that kind of stuff, but folks, days are clicking by. Opportunities are clicking by. Every day that passes was a group of opportunities that either we took or we neglected. And God is leading, but if we're not following him now, why should we expect him to lead us tomorrow? God leads us day by day. Here's a question. How can I know God's perfect will for my life? My wife and I spent 15 years working with college students, and this was a big question. Probably second only to, who am I going to marry? Okay, this was something we dealt with all the time. But, you know, what am I going to do with my life? What does God want me to do? I've got this interest and this interest. I'm not so sure what God wants me to do. I think we've got many, many times we wind up with preachers in the pulpit who God never called, and people in the pew, men in the pew that God called to preach, because we sort of missed it. That happens. This is my first line response when somebody says, Brother Dufour, I just don't know what God's will for my life is. Here I go. I'll ask him this canned response. Really not an answer, more of a question. Are you following God today? How's your today going? How much time have you spent with God today? Are you in your Bible? Meaning I'm trying to listen to what God has to say to me. Have you spent any time at all talking with the Lord? Are you living in obedience today, or are you living in rebellion to God today? Don't expect him to guide you and lead you tomorrow when you're squandering today. I found this. Rarely did God ever God has never spoken audibly to me. A few times I think I heard him say, hey, dummy. I think I heard him say that a few times. Or, what were you thinking? I think I've heard God say that a few times, something like that. But I have never heard God say, okay, now turn to the left. Take two steps forward. Never heard him say that. But what I have heard God say is, love the Lord your God with all your heart. Am I loving him like I'm supposed to today? It's so much more about what we're doing than where we're located. God will often take care of the location if we just do what we're supposed to do. Okay. Oh, I just don't know what God would want me to do. Let me ask you, what do you know God wants you to do? Okay, maybe it's time for you to quit smoking marijuana. I'm not looking at anybody. I have no idea if anybody in this room smokes marijuana. God, I'm totally seeking your will. It's amazing the voices you will hear. Well, I'm going to sit on this bar stool until God leads me. Yeah, I'm telling you now. We do some really foolish things and then expect God to direct us. Where God said, I've been talking to you for a long time and you've not been listening. How about if you do the first things that I told you to do? That you know I told you to do. This would be God speaking. Be sure you're following the known will of God today. He will lead you day by day. If you take each day and make it sacred and say, I am going to serve my Lord today. I'm going to give myself. That doesn't mean go on a mountain somewhere and put on some weird looking clothes and shave your head and go. That's not what it's talking about. What I'm talking about is, in a practical sense, I want to bring glory to God today as I get up and take a shower, get ready for the day, get dressed, go off to work, whatever that is, whatever I need to be doing. If I'm walking with the Lord and I'm fellowshipping with Him, He is going to direct my steps day by day. The conclusion of any journey is reached one step at a time. A successful life is lived one day at a time. God's will is revealed one day at a time. I never thought for one second that I would be pastoring a church 35 miles from Flint. What is it, 35 miles from Detroit? Detroit. I'm a youper. You never just said Detroit, you said Detroit. You know, you get south of Gaylord, and you know, you're in, you know, good heavens, if you lived in St. Ignace, it was almost the Lower Peninsula. Come on, give me a break. I never thought I'd wind up here. I never thought of it, not for a second. Never crossed my mind. I didn't know Imlay City existed. Did not know it. But you know what I had to do? I just had to keep putting one foot in front of the other, following the will of the Lord, doing what God would have me to do, trying to take each day one step at a time. God, what would you have me to do today? And I'm not saying that I always did everything that God told me to do every day. But I'm telling you, God would have never led me here had not I been submissive to His will where I was. It's revealed one day at a time. I wish He'd just show me the big master plan, but it'd probably scare me to death or discourage me. Okay? So God leads us one day at a time. God provides for us day by day. He said, when you pray, give us this day our daily bread. Proverbs 27:1 says, to boast not thyself of tomorrow. We had a fellow one time who had pledged to give us about $150,000 for a building project. And I believe that his heart was right. I believe that he sincerely wanted to give that $150,000. He had made an investment. And he had not followed up on that investment. He had a friend of the family had invested this money, and the friend said, you got a lot of money. Went back to find out that the friend of the family had been embezzling the money. The money was gone. He thought he had a fortune. And Brother Bishop, he had nothing. Oh my. It's amazing what that day can bring forth. You might be comfortable today and not tomorrow. I'm not trying to scare anybody, but we all know the realities of this. If you got a 401k or something like that, you know immediately what happened in the presidential elections. And as soon as it was clear which way our country was going to go, you lost a lot of money. Some people lost a fortune. They lost a retirement. God has not provided us with or promised us tomorrow's resources. He's promised us today's resources. God always has a way of messing with my long-term plans. How about you? I got it all figured out. And shazam! There was a life-altering situation that I am now facing. I never thought it was going to be this way. Well, God knew it was going to be that way all along. And He's going to provide every day for you. He's going to take care of you. God has a way of messing up my plans, but God always comes through and makes sure that I've got what I need. The Bible says that sufficient for the day is the evil thereof. For the day. So you know what I shouldn't be doing? I should not be worrying about the evil tomorrow. Should I be concerned about it? Sure. Should I be making some plans? Sure. There's nothing wrong with that. But when we set back And we say, what happened? What'll happen if? What'll happen if? What'll happen if? I've pastored long enough to know that most of those what ifs don't happen. And all we do is we waste our time expecting them to happen, and they don't happen. The fact, how many of you, we've done this before, how many of you in here, you've been in an experience in your life and thought, I don't think I could live another day. Anybody like that? I don't think I can make it through. Oh, but look around. Guess who's here? We made it. We made it through that 24-hour period of time. What does that mean? God will provide day by day as we need it. So not only are we not supposed to boast ourselves of tomorrow, we're not supposed to fret about tomorrow either, because he takes care of us day by day. And I want to look at a verse, 2 Corinthians. I want to close with this morning. In 2 Corinthians, I'm not going to really develop this thought very deeply, but this is something for you just to be thinking about. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 14. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 14. Knowing that he which raised up the Lord Jesus shall raise up us also by Jesus and shall present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. Oh my, oh my, how many sleepless nights, and you're thinking the sun's never going to come up. And it's amazing. God gives you breath for another day. How many times you look over at the clock, it's 1 o'clock in the morning, I can't sleep. And you lay there and you look at it again, it's 2 o'clock. And you're dreading the sunrise because you're thinking, oh no, I don't know if I can do this. And the next day comes and you wake up and you find that the Bible is true, that his mercies are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Okay, see, we get renewed day by day. There are some days, I think, before the 24 hours are up, I'm depleted. I'm just done. I just can't, I don't know. I don't know if I can make it through this. Beautiful sunrise this morning. I don't know if you saw it or not. Gorgeous sunrise this morning. That sunrise is supposed to give us the hope that once again, God has filled our tank full of mercy. And in a 24-hour period of time, you might spend every bit of that mercy. But when you wake up the next morning, the tank's full again. That means I can make it. Some of you are going through some pretty deep water right now, and I know that. Some of you are going through some deep water, and I don't know it. Nobody knows it. But I want to tell you that you can trust this one thing. With the rising of the sun comes the mercies of God. And God will give you the mercy to be able to go through the day. It's day by day. The choice is ours. Choose you this day whom you will serve. Scripture says that. The Bible also tells us that today is the day of salvation. Don't put it off. Don't wait. Why? It's today. Today is the day. Today is the opportunity. Seize the day. Grapple with the day. Don't let the day go. Get everything we can out of the day. Love as much as we can in the day. Work for God as much as we can during the day. Be a blessing to others as much as we can during the day. Hey, live for God. Smile. Realizing this might be the day that Jesus might come again. Maybe this is the day that the Lord's made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I'm so thankful that you gave us this day. And you know, Lord, those nights where I personally have watched the clock turn to 1 and then to 2, to 3, and sometimes to 4. And just wondering if the day is going to come, the morning is going to come. And if the morning comes, what we're going to be able to do. Lord, you know that I've personally been there. I know that many people have as well that are in this room. Now, Lord, I pray that you would help us to choose this day. Now, our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. Maybe you're here and you would say, Pastor, I need that message. I feel low today. I feel depleted today. I need that message. I'm praying that God would restore me and renew me today, that I would have his strength, that I'd follow his will, that I would live victorious, that I'd rest in his promises today. Pastor, pray for me. Is there anyone like that today? God bless you. Good heavens, a third of the people in the auditorium. Amen. You can put your head back down. Maybe you're here today and you hear a little knock at your door. Could that be the Holy Spirit saying, today's the day of salvation? Maybe you're here today and you don't know for sure you're going to heaven. Oh, please. Before the door is shut, before the time is up, before the good fruit turns to evil, please, would you like to trust Christ today? Maybe you're here and you say, I don't know for sure I'm going to heaven, but Pastor, I would like to know. Please pray for me. Is there anyone like that? Just slip your hand up. Let me pray for you. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to come to you. Is there anyone like that this morning? Maybe those that watch us on the internet, be considering that. Jesus is the difference between a glorious eternity, an eternity, or an eternity separated from God in the depths of hell. Jesus is the difference. Heavenly Father, I pray that you'd bless this invitation now. Bless it, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand for our invitation. If God's spoken to your heart, why don't you come at this time?
Number 484. 484.
Tenderly, Jesus is calling.
if I could get someone up here to help me move the podium.
Saved, and you maybe even did it more than once, but you know in your heart it was not something that was between you and God, that it was something that didn't had no eternal bearing. It was just words. And so I put a little bit of words in his mouth. This is what Jeremiah told us. He said it was real to me. I just got saved, and I feel like, well, that's part of my problem, is that I wasn't really saved. And so he trusted Christ as his Savior. And so we're glad, so glad to baptize him today. And so, Jeremiah, have you trusted Christ as your Savior?
Yes, I have.
All right, Jeremiah, why don't you put your feet right up in the air and cross your arms. Okay. Go ahead and hold your nose. Okay, hold your nose. In obedience to the command of our Lord and Master, and upon your public profession of your faith in him, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of his death. Thank you. I have it written on my hand. Buried in the likeness of his death.